pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
City Clerk, would you call the roll, please?
Yes, Your Honor. Commissioner Kimbenzi.
Here.
Commissioner Campana.
Here.
Commissioner Coyne.
Here.
Commissioner Reynolds.
Here.
Commissioner Ryan.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse.
Here.
And Mayor Nemi.
Here. Thank you, City Clerk. The next item is note of agenda changes. We do have a few changes. One, we want to omit item 8F from the consent agenda. That's where regarding the Rotary Club requesting our permission to access money from their money in trust for the Kids Cove Endowment. It's come to our awareness that they can go directly to the Community Foundation to ask for it. They don't need our permission or need to go through us, so we can eliminate that. The next item, I will move up the hockey team presentation from item number 3 to actually item number 1, unless someone objects. And the last item, we need to add a closed session. Is there a motion on?
I will motion closed session for the purpose of discussing the We Energy Tax Tribunal.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner. Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, is there a support? Commissioner Reynolds?
Second.
Okay. It's been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, supported by Commissioner Reynolds, to add an item of closed session. We'll put that as number 14 on the agenda to discuss retaining counsel for the We Energies Tax Tribunal case. So, is there a motion to approve the agenda as amended? Commissioner Ryan?
I would move.
Okay. Support. Commissioner Kimbenzi?
Support.
Okay, it's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Commissioner Kimbenzi to approve the agenda as amended. All in favor say yes.
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 Any opposed say no. The motion passes unanimously. The next item is announcements. We've got a series of, as usual, city boards and commissions that have vacancies. I encourage people to go to the city website. I'm not going to read them all. It's a typical list that we have. We have a nice, easy application on the city website. You can fill it out online. You can mail it in, or you could print it out and bring it into the city manager's office. And I'd encourage people to get involved as volunteers for their city government. One other item I wanted to call attention to, it's with regret that earlier this month, Craig Buck Buchanan passed away. He was 62 years old, and Mr. Buchanan is well known within the city. He supports a lot of youth programs, and most notably, he was responsible for, he was the driving force behind the city being named World Frisbee Sanctuary by WAMO, and also developing a frisbee disc golf course in the city and in Chocolate Township. And so the city extends its sympathies and condolences to the family and friends of Buck Buchanan, and I'd like everyone to join me in a moment of silence in remembrance of Buck, please. Okay, thank you. We've got the Marquette Girls Under 10 hockey team here, and if the team members and the coaches would meet me at the podium. I have some certificates I'd like to present. The coaches, would you come on over here? What is the state champs? Okay. We have the Marquette Girls Under 10 hockey team here, the 2013-2014 state champions. I think, as I mentioned last meeting when we had another girls hockey team, Detroit is not Hockey City USA in Michigan. Marquette is Hockey City USA. This is the fourth championship girls team. We've had a championship boys team, and we have other teams that also competed at various levels. But it's just amazing. The girls, they just keep coming. They're just all champions. So we have some certificates of achievement. First to Greg Mishka, coach. Thank you, Greg. Mike, thank you, Jim. For the players, we have Madison Mishka. And Kylie Lane. Brianna Modell. And this is Anna Bishek. Sorry about that. Mackenzie Turney. And Lindsay Lake. Abby Bergman. Thank you, Abby. Lily Wilkinson. And Ava Young. And if we could give a big round of applause for the entire team that coached.
Awesome.
Thank you, girls. Okay, the next item on the agenda is single lot special assessments, roll number 580. City Clerk, do you have some background to read on this?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. Chapter 40, Section 40-21 of the City Code excuse me, requires that when an improvement shall have been made by the city upon or in respect to any single premises, the expense of which is chargeable against such premises and the owner thereof under the provisions of this chapter and is not of that class required to be prorated among several lots and parcels of land as in a special assessment district, an account of the cost to be charged to the owner shall be reported to the city treasurer, who shall immediately bill the owner if known. The city code further requires that when the city treasurer determines that a number of properties have had an outstanding bills for a sufficient time, the treasurer shall notify the city assessor, who shall prepare a single lot assessment roll and schedule a public hearing for the city commission on that roll. Impacted property owners on the attached list have received notification of the time and place of the hearing in accordance with Section 40-21 of the City Code. Fiscal effect, which has changed from the original publication to $1,194.70 plus accruing interest and penalties. Recommendation following the public hearing, confirm single lot special assessment roll number 580 and authorize the mayor to sign the warrant. Alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, City Clerk. I'll now open the public hearing on the single lot special assessment roll number 580. Are there any citizens wishing to address the commission on this item? Anyone wishing to address the city commission? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Fellow commissioners, what is your pleasure regarding this item? Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
I have a motion to confirm the single lot special assessment roll 580 and authorize the mayor to sign a warrant.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Commissioner Cambenzi?
Support.
Thank you. It's been moved by Commissioner Stonehouse, seconded by Commissioner Cambenzi, to approve single lot special assessment roll number 580. Anything further, Commissioner or Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
No, thank you.
Anything further, Commissioner Cambenzi?
Nothing further.
Okay. All in favor of the motion, say yes.
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 Any opposed motion, say no. The motion passes unanimously. The next item is Is this actually a public hearing on the?
Yes.
Okay. We have a public hearing on the Delft Theater Project Grant. City Clerk, do you have a background to read?
Yes, Your Honor. On February 10th, 2014, the City Commission approved the Downtown Development Authority submission on behalf of the city, a Part 1 application for a community development block grant redevelopment for direct assistance to a business based on a job creation grant to the Michigan Economic Development Corporation, MEDC, for redevelopment of the former Delft Theater located at 138 West Washington Street. A letter of interest was received from the MEDC on March 21st, 2014, and the city was invited to submit a Part 2 application for grant funding in the amount of $481,000. The required environmental review record has been completed and advertised as required. In addition, certain public participation requirements are necessary, including a public hearing on the proposed project and a authorizing resolution to be adopted after the completion of the hearing. Fiscal effect none. Recommendation following a public hearing: approve the proposed Delft Theater Project Part 2 application submittal for grant funds and authorize the city manager to sign the application and statement of assurances for the project alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, City Clerk. The presentation, would that be part of the public hearing, Mr. Manager, or should we do that separately?
Yeah. We've actually got the developer here with us this evening. He can make a presentation before or after the public hearing, whatever the commission would find most convenient. He's been in and given us a presentation on the project earlier this year. So,
well, I guess he could do it in the hearing. It's just the transcript may have to reflect the entire presentation then. Well, we'll do it that way. I'll open the hearing. Mr. Veer, did you have a presentation to make on the Delft project?
Can I get to stand up here?
Yes.
Thank you very much, Commissioners. My name is Tom Veer. I'm the developer. My wife and I are the developer of the Delft Theater, and on behalf of the DDA and the MEDC, we're in application of this grant. My presentation has been previously made. I didn't have a prepared presentation for this. I understood that this was a public comment period, and I'm happy to answer any questions on the project that was previously presented at the commission, I believe. The project is 139 West Washington, the Delft Theater. It's a remodel and redo of the old Delft Theater with the marquee and the building that encompasses about 8,000 square feet. It will be redeveloped into, excuse me, a dinner theater. And thanks to the public citizens and the commission's help, it will be a very hopefully successful and enjoyable project. So if there's any questions, I'm happy to answer any of those. And if there's any other comments, I'm happy to listen to those.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Veer. Why don't we check to see if there's any further citizens to address it regarding this before we launch into questions.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to address the commission regarding the Delft Theater Project Grant? Ms. Lang?
I'm Mona Lang. I'm the Executive Director for the Downtown Development Authority. I'm here to answer any questions, and I also want to make available the Part 1 and Part 2 application for the grant for the Delft project. The project is a $1.8 million project. It's going to create 25 jobs. We are excited about it. I think as a community, this has been a treasure for the community. We've looked forward to seeing particularly the Washington Street facade of this remodeled, repaired, restored, and we are excited. The grant is for $481,000. The final comment period from the state of Michigan is June 14th. Shortly after that, we will be going to the MEDC. We will be requesting permission to spend private dollars from the developer at that point, and then we will be coming back to the commission, hopefully with a grant agreement. We feel very confident that this project is going to move forward, the original Part 1 application we brought to you in February. And so this is a long process, and we are excited to see it move to this point. So if anyone in the community or if the commission has any questions, I am certainly here to answer those questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lang. Any further, any citizens wishing to address the commission during the public hearing on the Delft Theater Project Grant? Hearing none, I'll close the public hearing portion. Fellow commissioners, what is your pleasure regarding this item? Commissioner Ryan?
I would move we approve the proposed Delft Theater Project Part 2 application submittal for grant funds and authorize the city manager to sign the application and statement of assurances for the project.
Thank you. Commissioner Coyne? Thank you. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
Well, as was pointed out, this is not the first time we've had this report, and this is a continuing project. I guess just to emphasize again, this is almost a $2 million project, so there's a substantial investment by the developers as well. And, of course, this grant will help make the project a reality. I think it's also, again, one more indication of, I think we've all discussed, in fact, recently, the what an important role the downtown plays in identifying Marquette as a vibrant community, and this is just one more step in that process. So I think it's very positive.
Thank you, Commissioner Ryan. Commissioner Coyne, anything further?
Yes, I think this is a great project, and downtown is already well known throughout the state as a really great downtown. I happen to be looking at TripAdvisor, which is a online monitoring of and evaluating things, and I was looking up Presque Isle because we'd gotten some information about how they had just received a very prestigious rating. So I thought, well, you know, I'm going to look up Marquette. So I looked up Marquette on TripAdvisor, and great comments from all over the country, literally. And interestingly, one of them was from someone in Texas rating downtown Marquette as 4.5 out of 5. And their comment was, it'll be a 5 when the Delft Theater Project is done, because it will be the kind of keystone to the development of downtown. And I think that's really true. It's going to be a vibrant addition to an already vibrant place. And I hope that you're able to get the grant and appreciate the huge investment that you folks have made. So I hope you'll all support it.
Thank you, Commissioner Coyne. Any other commissioners, any comments regarding the motion for approving the Delft Theater Project Grant? Hearing none, I guess I'd just kind of like to echo what Commissioner Ryan pointed out, that the developer is putting up the $3 for every $1 of grant dollars, so he's making a significant investment into our downtown, and I think that's, you know, the grant is certainly helpful, and it'll in effect leverage, you know, three to one match. So I think that's a great thing. It's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Commissioner Coyne, to approve the application submitted for grant funds and authorize the city manager to sign the application and statement of insurances for the project. All in favor of the motion say yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Anyone opposed to the motion say no. The motion passes unanimously. The next item is boards and committees. I have recognition of outgoing members. Would Linda Smith, Sally Davis, and Bob Frazee meet me at the podium? Okay, Ms. Linda Smith. You're an outgoing member of the Arts and Culture Advisory Committee. We have a T-shirt, a pin, and a certificate to
thank you.
Give you. And we appreciate your service on the Advisory Committee.
I enjoy it. Thank you.
Sally Davis Campana, this is a... You're an outgoing member of the Harbor Advisory Committee. We also have a pin, a certificate, and a T-shirt for you, and we appreciate your
service on the committee. Thank you. And Robert Frazee, you're an outgoing member of the Harbor Advisory Committee. We've got the same for you, a pin, a certificate, and a t-shirt.
All right.
And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, that's... Okay, the next item is we have to welcome a new member of Tim McIntosh for the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board.
There we go.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. I noticed you had two pins and I didn't realize what the second one was. Thank you. You just get a pin to start out.
Well, I'll earn the t-shirt.
Yes.
Okay.
And thank you very much. We welcome you to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Committee. And I think the example of the three outgoing members and yours is the highest credit the city can have when we have citizens who are willing to step forward and help us provide the needs of the city.
Thank you, sir. Looking forward to it.
Okay, the next item is appointments. We have an appointment of Joshua Morrison to the Presque Isle Park Advisory Committee for a term ending April 1st, 2017. Fellow commissioners, what is your pleasure regarding this? Commissioner Ryan?
I'll move we appoint Joshua Morrison to the Presque Isle Park Advisory Committee for a term ending April 1st, 2017.
Okay, is there support or second for the motion? Commissioner Cambenzi?
Support.
Thank you. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
No, just again, as we're always pleased to have these folks step forward to fill in these positions.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Cambenzi?
I'll just echo Commissioner Ryan.
Thank you. It's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Commissioner Cambenzi, to appoint Joshua Morrison to the Presque Isle Park Advisory Committee for a term ending April 1st, 2017. All in favor say yes.
Yes.
Anyone opposed say no. The motion passes unanimously. The next item is a reappointment of Chloe Wilkinson to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board for a term ending June 1st, 2015. Chloe is an ex officio. She'll be a senior in high school this year. She served 1 year as an ex officio member from the student council the high school on the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. And we should reappoint her now to serve the next year. Is there a motion? Commissioner Ryan?
I'll move we reappoint Chloe Wilkinson to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board for a term ending June 1st, 2015.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Commissioner Campana?
I'll second that.
Okay. It's been moved. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
No, we're certainly glad to have young people involved in these boards, and this is one example of that. So glad to have her stay with us.
Thank you. Commissioner Campana?
Same. Glad to have her with us.
Okay. It's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Commissioner Campana, to appoint Chloe Wilkinson to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board as an ex officio member for a term ending June 1st, 2015. All in favor say yes.
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 Anyone opposed say no. The motion passes unanimously. We are now at the portion of the meeting, which is public comment. Comments may not exceed 3 minutes per person. Please state your name and physical address prior to making your comments. Anyone wishing to address the meeting or the commission? The podium right in front here? Yeah.
This podium right here?
Yes. Is the microphone on there? Should be a
hello. Light. Yes, it is. I'll bend down. I'm kind of tall. First, let me say sorry about my voice. I'm still getting over a sickness, but
we need a name and address. Your name and address.
Okay, my name is Drew Dunn. I'm from Salt Lake City, Utah.
Okay.
So you want that address in Utah then, or?
That's sufficient.
Okay. I'm here on behalf of the Run or Die event. Our company is Base Camp Events, and we're doing the 5K Run or Die event on June 28th. So just a little bit about what we do. We call ourselves the world's most colorful 5K. It's 3.1 miles. Thousands of people come out on June 28th. It's at Elwood Matson Park. And basically how it works is the start time starts at 9 a.m. They run 3 miles during the route. There's 5 color stations, and that's where the runners run through color, and our volunteers throw the colors colored cornstarch. So there's 5 of those. At the end of the route, they come to our festival area where we have a stage, dancing, and we give all the runners a packet of color also. And during that festival area, we have die throws where everyone in the crowd throws the color at the same time. It's a really quick event. It's no more than about 3 hours, but it really is fun. I mean, we do it all over the country. This last weekend, I was in Flint, Michigan, and then just drove here, and it was awesome. So we're really excited to do it in Marquette. And I don't just say this to every city, but this city is beautiful. So I just text all my staff, and I said, look forward to June 28th, because this city is absolutely gorgeous. After the event, though, I'm sure you guys are worried about the color. We have power sprayers and sweepers that come in. Our goal is to make it look like we never were here. By Saturday afternoon, everything will be cleaned. Power sprayers do a great job, and we make sure that we don't leave a city till it's spotless. So that's kind of what we do.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think I've got the same bug, so hopefully. My name is Nancy Bukema, and Greg and I live at 1111 North 7th Street. First, I would like to thank Carl and his staff and the marina staff for a wonderful opening of Cinder Pond Marina. Got a little cold and a little rainy a couple times, but it was so wonderful to have the marina open. I am here to address the MGH heliport on the corner of Magnetic and 7th Street. Neighbors were never informed about the MGH heliport plan. We feel completely left out of the process. We are looking for assistance in scheduling a neighborhood meeting with city officials and staff and Marquette General Hospital Duke Life Point representatives. Two, we want to see the existing heliport plans referring to landing safety. The exact placement of the helipad on the existing hospital lot. The traffic disruption and control. Power line height factors. Our beautiful trees. The flight approach. Flight regulations related to schools, cemeteries, NMU. Noise level control. Estimate of the number of flights per year. 240 flights a year is rumored. Rotor wash effects on cars, homes, and landscaping. Effects on neighborhood property values. Three, we have a question about flight costs and insurance coverage for patients, something people need to know. Four, we are also wondering about the air ambulance company's commitment to our area, particularly with the hospital's projected move. Also questions as to why the previous airlift service shut down. The Director of Communications for Marquette General Hospital portrayed the neighborhood as non-caring in last Thursday's Mining Journal. There isn't enough time tonight for me to go through a long list of reasons why that just is not true. I don't think Marquette General Hospital has any idea of who we are or which houses we live in. We are first and foremost upset that such a plan has moved so far without any consideration for our rights to be informed. We learned about the plan from a neighbor who overheard a conversation of Marquette General Hospital staff people while being treated in the emergency room. That was 3 weeks ago. Whether by the city or Marquette General Hospital, we should have been included way before a helicopter landing and press conference was scheduled on our corner. Something has to be said for our concerns when they actually had to move that event to the Berry Event Center. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bukema. Anyone else wishing?
Hi again. I'm Sue Hewitt from 701 West Magnetic. And three weeks ago, I knew nothing about medical helicopters, except that they save people. I now know that before there's one landing 100 feet from my front yard, someone, like the City Commission and the city planners, should study its location and flight route very carefully. I would like to share a few quotes from just one internet article. I know full well how skewed data can be, so I invite you to read the numerous sites online yourself. It didn't take long to find this one. This article was, "Medical Helicopters, Worth the Cost or Risk?" Dr. Jessica Nonan, ABC Medical Unit via World News, April 17, 2012. According to the National Transportation Board, 2008 saw 12 crashes involving medical helicopters, seven of which were fatal. Medical helicopters have a higher ratio of accidents to the number of flight hours than any other types of aviation. These potential downsides have some experts concerned that these flights are just not worth it. The Journal of American Medical Health Association says transportation to the hospital by helicopter for trauma patients is linked to a 1.5 increase of rate of survival compared to the ground transportation such as ambulance. Helicopter emergency medical services is the most dangerous form of helicopter transportation, says Dr. Jeffrey Grabich, medical director of EMS and disaster preparedness at St. Luke's Roosevelt Hospital in New York. They often launch in marginal weather, and there have been numerous crashes killing all on board, including the patient. Researchers at Johns Hopkins Medical Center studied 200,000 patients. They matched the patients with similar characteristics and levels of injury. They found a small increased rate of survival in helicopter-transported patients. How expensive is the service to a patient? Well, in Maryland, in this article, the answer was $5,000. A personal relative, it was $17,000. Is it covered by their insurance? This should be explained to the patient. If the ground-level transport time exceeds 60 minutes, a helicopter would save more time. If the ground-level speed is less than 60 minutes, the helicopter is not saving much time, Dr. Rabich said. As the distance to the trauma center decreases, the helicopter time advantage dissipates rapidly. Dr. Michael West, professor of surgery at UC San Francisco, says, instead of helicopters, more emphasis should be placed on packing ambulances with better equipment and enhancing paramedic training.
You're going to need to finish up soon, ma'am.
Okay, conclusion. A 1.5 helicopter success rate over ambulance service is a small number, unless it's you, me, or our family members. I'm not against the service. I'm against the landing pad so close to an area of town which also houses many residences, two schools, churches, school buses, ambulances, and many NMU student cars on their way to school. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else wishing to address the commission?
Well, I don't have a cold or a virus, but if I pass out, I hope somebody can do CPR. Honorable City Commissioners and Mayor, my name is Susan Holliday. I live at 1002 West College in Marquette. This is the first time I've ever spoken to a city commission, although I was encouraged in the past. The time is right, and the time is now. The Upper Peninsula Rainbow Pride Committee is extending a public invitation to the mayor, the members of the City of Marquette Commission, and their families to join in the first celebration of the annual Upper Peninsula Rainbow Pride Festival being held on 6 September 2014. This is the first Pride Festival in the UP. The committee hopes to highlight the week with the mayoral declaration of Pride Day for that Saturday, if you will so, sir. It is our vision that during that week, the Peter White Public Library will put on a display of books related to gay, lesbian, bisexual, queer, transgender, intersex, and asexual literature to help educate the public, dispel stereotypes, as well as reduce prejudices, as they might or they may not. And perhaps a related movie of a historical nature to our history. The next event will begin on 6 September with a walk of interested parties from the Commons, picking up those who are not so athletic at the Dome, and then proceeding to the Tourist Park. At the Tourist Park, we will have an MC to begin the festival around 2 p.m., which will last through quiet hours, as stated by the city. The activities will be highlighted by local artisans, vendors, beer and food, because that's important to the UP, music by Double Trouble for dancing, an open mic for local artists who want to play and strum and drum, a small segments from the Negaunee Pack with the Rocky Horror Picture Show, and Dancing with the Stars, and perhaps during that day, any one of the commissioners who are there can help crown the first Miss Marquette LGBTQIA. We hope you'll come out, show your support, and enjoy the fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to address the commission?
My name is Craig Miller. I live at 1013 Alloway Road up in Shiras Hills in Marquette, Michigan. I just wanted to add some public comment addressing the continuing work on the infrastructure, especially up in Shiras Hills and Lakeshore Heights. I was last year, you did a beautiful job on Alloway, and I had heard that Jonathan Carver was supposed to be the next street up in 2014, and then I heard it got pushed back. I don't know. But if there's one thing I learned this winter is that with all the frozen water lines and I think that broken main up in 7th Street, it's much cheaper, I think, in the long run to get all that infrastructure done as quickly as possible instead of digging up aging infrastructure, patching it together, and hoping for the best. Because I think we had, what would Marquette have, about $1 million in costs concerning the frozen water lines, the mains and stuff. I understand we did get disaster relief from the state and the federal government, but this should be a prime example of that it, in the long run, it is cheaper because the new infrastructure is supposed to last for 100 years. And there are some streets up East Nicolet certainly needs a new street. And Brule Road, that section that wasn't done, it almost looks like it belongs in a demilitarized zone. In fact, I tripped and took a flop there a couple of times because I didn't watch where I was going, and I hit a pothole. And even West Nicolet, it's starting to show its age. It looks like it needs to be at least resurfaced. But this and anywhere else, and I have a color-coded map of the city, would certainly help to get this stuff done. And then hopefully in the future we don't have to, our costs would be a lot less. I don't know what the situation is with the disaster. I heard we had gotten it, but I'm not clear as to whether it's in effect yet or not. But I'm glad of that, and if we did, I'm glad of that. And also I supported the trucking route for Lundin Mining because that $700,000 a year is going to save the city a lot of money in upkeep on the route. And that's all I got to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to address the commission?
Bob Hewitt, 701 West Magnetic Street. Hello again. Well, I guess we certainly can say that we've heard about the helicopter since the last time we were here. And while, you know, there's a number of things that we could talk about again, I guess. But, you know, I want to echo what Nancy said and what I'm not sure if Sue said it. But, you know, we're certainly not against the helicopter or saving lives. What we're against is having this helipad 100 feet from our homes. It defies common sense as far as I'm concerned. I understand that the Planning Commission, I guess, has some type of zoning regarding the hospital, or allowed some type of zoning regarding the hospital. I don't know. I'm not speaking directly with facts, but more of what I've heard. That, in fact, allows them to do things like this without talking to anybody, obviously. Obviously, most of you didn't know this was going on. And I think Mr. Vito only knew shortly before this was going on. But in spite of that, one of the comments was that, well, they have certain rights within this zoning thing. Well, hello again. Do we have rights as a citizen in the city of Marquette? I mean, I would certainly hope so. And we would like, you know, our voices to be heard. Again, you know, if we save one life, that's great. Nobody's arguing that. Again, we're arguing the proximity, the fact that this was done the way it was done, and frankly, it's mind-boggling to me that they're going to do this. And I encourage you to come over to our corner and take a look in front of Margaret's house or my house or Mrs. Schillinger across the street. I mean, you know, I can't throw very far anymore, but I can throw a rock and hit that helicopter, I guarantee you that. We have grandchildren in our home 3-4 days a week, 4 and under, sometimes 3 of them. It just scares me to think what might happen, you know, some of the stuff that Sue was reading and or saying to you. So, again, I thank you for the opportunity to speak. I would hope that you would consider our issue with this and look at it from our perspective. If it's a done deal, well, I guess it's too late. But on the other hand, it's certainly something that I would have appreciated knowing ahead of time, so we could have been in the at the beginning of this thing in the forefront of it. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. Anyone else wishing to address the commission?
Frank Jeff Faraday, 350 East Ridge, Marquette. These are my opinions. You're reminded that more high-risk intersections need pedestrian crossing signs. Your waterfront safety program has changed the ambiance of McCarty's Cove from laid-back to less easygoing. You ignore those who spend the most time there. Instead, you clutter a beach with more lifeguard stands, buoys, and signs, yet you care less if the dune grasses are trampled or if Picnic Rocks is guarded at all. Although most of all drowning occurs at Picnic Rocks, you've dedicated disproportionate resources on stretches with no history of problems. Park cops are asked to stay off the beach except at Picnic Rocks unless a guard calls them. Keep alcohol illegal on the beach, but let the lifeguards use their discretion as to whether a drinker is out of control. If so, call the police to arrest him. To date, it's rarely a problem. May 27th, Campana mentioned his unfamiliarity with the Clark's Park site, and he later asked where the restroom was planned at Williams Park. You're required to know the locations of these important projects prior to the meeting, or don't bother showing up. Dave's ill-preparedness is reflected in his performance. He keeps echoing the rest of you. I apologize for lashing out at a good man, but his failure to come prepared bolsters my point that he's not suited for the job. So long as he evidently follows Coyne's lead, maybe there is no reason for him to prepare. Before our May 27th meeting, Coyne said good evening to me in the men's room. I politely said, excuse me, to access a paper towel. He then repeated his good evening more assertively. Through his kind gesture, he matched his audacity of January 30, 2012, when he thrice threatened me in the same infamous room. He's ignored 6 years of public opinions, answered for nothing. He acted as a prime mover to steal our closing comment to avoid being held accountable for himself, and he voted to destroy Wooded Lakeshore for a boathouse on top of his 2012 men's room meltdown, and he expects acknowledgement from me on his command. Plus, he allegedly lied to a man about the haul route. You so counted on CR 595, you faced a dilemma, partly of your own creation, for failing to look ahead to this issue years earlier, hence your no-brainer decision. Your hands were tied. In fact, Campana agreed, quote, there's no choice. Hundreds of people are working. It's a financial incentive, end quote. Impact to our quality of life meant nothing. You rushed to vote, as you so often do. Most frightful were Stonehouse's hopes that if a bypass is built, the county will open up to more economic development. If Fred is this bent on exploiting our county and lakeshore, why didn't he stay out east where there's so much more money to be made? Don't encourage outdated mentality here. Bring us high-tech jobs. While we still have awesome places to protect, please progress out of the third world.
Thank you, Mr. Barreto. Anyone else wishing to address the commission? Anyone else wishing to address the commission? Hearing none, I'll close that portion of the meeting, and we will proceed on to the consent agenda. We have, if you commissioners recall, we've removed items 8F, so we have the remainder for approval. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda? Commissioner Ryan?
I move we can approve the consent agenda as amended.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse.
I second the motion.
Thank you. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
No, again, basically routine matters.
Okay. Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, anything further? Any further comment?
No, thank you.
Okay. It's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse to approve the consent agenda as amended. All in favor say yes.
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 Yes. Yes.
Any opposed say no. The motion is approved unanimously. We will now move on to new business. Item number 9 is East Hewitt Avenue Reconstruction Project. City Clerk, do you have some background to read, please?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. This project was made possible with grant funds provided by MDOT Surface Transportation Program and funding approved during the fiscal year 2013-14 budget process. The engineering department has been working on programming the project with MDOT, acquired the necessary water and sanitary sewer permits, and public hearings were conducted with the Planning Commission. At this time, the project is on the MDOT bid letting schedule for June 6, 2014, with a planned summer construction start. Under these grant programs, the City of Marquette designs, inspects, and administers the project, and MDOT advertises, holds a contract, and pays a contractor. In turn, the City of Marquette contracts with MDOT and reimburses MDOT for expenses over and above the grant amount. The next step in the process is the signing of these contracts with MDOT. Fiscal effect, the execution of this contract will result in up to $375,000 in grant money to the City of Marquette. The city match to satisfy the grant requirements for the project is up to $226,700, and funds have been allocated in the FY13-14 budget to cover the match and the additional utility costs. Recommendation by resolution, authorize the mayor and city clerk to sign the contract with MDOT for the East Hewitt Avenue Reconstruction Project, alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, city clerk. Fellow commissioners, what is your pleasure regarding this project? Commissioner Ryan?
I move we pass a resolution authorizing the mayor and city clerk to sign a contract with the MDOT for the East Hewitt Avenue Reconstruction Project.
Okay. Is there a second to the motion? Commissioner Reynolds?
Second.
Thank you. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
No, that this is just one more opportunity to work on a problem that's not a problem, but an ongoing situation of trying to improve the infrastructure in the ground. I wonder if I could maybe throw a curve at Keith Whittington or someone. What would it cost to do our entire capital improvement project, the long-term plan we have? $50 million, $100 million, what was, do you recall the number? Maybe Dennis does.
Well, that is a tough one, and I think that's probably a question that would be better answered if we could go back and look at the SIP and respond.
Yeah, thank you. If you consider for a moment that it's about $1.5 million with contingency for 1 mile of complete reconstruction of the street, if we were going to do all 100 miles of the city streets, it'd be about $150 million. And then if you were going to replace every facility we had, all the buildings and everything else, you're probably looking at another $100 million. So if we had $250 million, we could upgrade everything at the same time.
And I just want to point that out because, you know, people do wonder why we do certain projects, why we don't get more done. And it's understandable because I drive on some of these roads too and wonder why they don't get fixed. But this commission several years ago decided that we would limit our borrowing to $4 million a year so that we didn't continue to increase our debt. And with that, we're not even able to keep pace. So it's a problem the city is going to have to deal with. But we have a lot of aging infrastructure, and as the manager pointed out, we could be, you know, just pulling numbers out of the air, you know, talking about $250 million to get that done. So it's something we have to keep chipping away at, and this is one more example of us getting some help to get it done. So appreciate staff work.
Thank you, Commissioner Ryan. Commissioner Reynolds, anything further on this item?
Nothing further.
Okay. Commissioner Coyne?
I have a question of the city manager. Why is East Hewitt being singled out as opposed to another street? What process, how did that rise to the top?
Thank you, sir. Why don't I have Keith maybe take the dais and explain a little bit about the capital improvement process, how we got there.
Try to answer this for you. As you know, we have a capital improvement plan that was done back in 2005. It was a six-year plan, which is actually kind of extended further. But during that time, there was a series of public events and processes that went through as far as prioritizing which streets were going to be done at which time. As part of the plan, you look at the useful service life of a particular infrastructure item, such as water main, usually lasts 75 years, maybe 100 if you're lucky. So you want to try to at least replace some of that every year. And if you have 90 miles of water main in town, then if you have 75, it comes out to be about a mile per year is what your goal is. Based on that, based on the age of the water main, which I believe is at 1888, on Hewitt Avenue, based upon the sewer main, which is close to the same age. The street, I think you're aware of our PASER ratings. PASER rating is a 3 in that area. So bringing those all those parameters together brought it towards the top there. It wasn't the very top one at first. We've already gone through probably 5 years worth, so this just brought it up to that priority there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you. I just wasn't sure what basis it happened. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Yep.
I'm sure other people had that question, so appreciate the answer.
Can I just ask Keith a further question?
Yes.
Actually, aren't the water and sewer utilities often the driving factor in making that decision? I mean, you might look at a street that's you know, looks in need of repair, but on another street, which is also a street that needs repair, but underneath you have the kind of water and sewer utilities that you mentioned, it becomes more of a priority.
That's part of the process. How you want to prioritize it, I guess. I mean, there are some streets in town where the utilities underneath, I guess I would call her fairly new, which in our case is 1950s or 60s. So. Looking at those streets, but the street itself above it is in bad shape. I mean, for example, Sheriff's Hill is an example of that. So you don't have to do a total reconstruction there. So those type of streets aren't prioritized as highly or in a different category, I guess. It's, instead of being a total reconstruction of the street, it's more of a street upgrade where we just come through and remove the pavement, put curbing in, whatever needed, and then don't have to worry about the utilities underneath. But in this case, it's a total reconstruction because of the utilities below and the street above, so they all combine together to get it prioritized a little bit higher.
But I guess maybe another way to say it, it's tough to drive on a bumpy street, but it's even worse to have a lot of broken water mains and sewer mains, so that has to get kind of a top priority.
Yes, yep.
Especially when the water and sewer mains are 100 years old.
Yes.
Anything further from any commissioners? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. It's been moved by Commissioner Ryan, seconded by Commissioner Reynolds, to approve the resolution authorizing the mayor and city clerk to sign the contract with the Michigan Department of Transportation for the East Hewitt Avenue reconstruction project. All in favor, say yes.
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 Any opposed, say no. It's the resolution's passed unanimously. Unanimous roll call vote. Thank you, commissioners. The next item on the agenda is resolutions for unpaid stormwater and unpaid water and wastewater. Item number 10. City clerk, do you have a background?
Yes, Your Honor. Background, chapter 48-194 of the city code states unpaid stormwater service charges shall constitute a lien against the property affected from the date the charges were incurred. Charges which have remained unpaid for a period of 3 months prior to April 1st of any year may, after notice to the owner, by resolution of the City Commission, be certified to the City Assessor, who shall place the charges on the City Tax Roll. Chapter 48-123 of the City Code states charges for water and wastewater services shall constitute a lien against the property served. If not paid within 3 months after the same is due, the official in charge of the collection thereof shall, prior to April 1 and October 1, certify to the City Assessor the facts of such delinquency, whereupon the City Assessor shall enter such delinquent charges upon the next general city tax roll as a charge against such premises. And the lien thereof shall be enforced in the same manner as provided by law for delinquent and unpaid taxes. Fiscal effect, $1,445.40 plus accruing interest and penalty for delinquent stormwater, and $7,266.94 plus accruing interest and penalties for delinquent water and sewer accounts. Recommendation, adopt the resolutions to place unpaid stormwater, water, and wastewater utility charges on the next city tax roll for collection, and authorize the city clerk to sign the resolutions, alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, city clerk. Fellow commissioners, is there a motion to approve, adopt a resolution? Commissioner Coyne?
I move that we adopt the resolutions to place unpaid water, stormwater, water and wastewater utility charges on the next city tax roll for a collection, and authorize the city clerk to sign the resolutions.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
Second the motion.
Thank you. Commissioner Coyne, anything further on this item?
No.
Commissioner Stonehouse?
No.
Okay. It's been moved by Commissioner Coyne, seconded by Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, to adopt the resolutions place unpaid stormwater, water, and wastewater utility charges on the next city tax roll for collection, and authorize the city clerk to sign the resolutions. All in favor, say yes.
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 Anyone opposed, say no. The motion is passed unanimously and adopted on a unanimous roll call vote. Thank you. The next item, 11, is the Michigan Department of Natural Resources Waterways Grant Agreement. City Clerk, would you read the background information, please?
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you. And it's April 14th, 2014. The City Commission approved submitting an emergency grant application to the MDNR Waterways Division to fund demolition of the Cinder Pond Marina Harbor Service Building and relocation of utilities. The total grant amount is 50% of the anticipated cost for phase one of the project, or $79,100. The MDNR Waterways Commission met on April 25, 2014 to consider grant applications and approve the city's request. The emergency grant is a reimbursement agreement to be executed in the event scope of work items required to remove the structure and relocate utilities are not approved by the Michigan Municipal League Property and Liability Insurance Pool. City staff has discussed the project at length with MDNR staff and are in agreement as to how the grant proceeds will be applied toward the project. The grant agreement is a match reimbursement grant, 50% state and 50% local match. Fiscal effect, the grant requires a local match total to be determined by shortfalls from the insurance claim. recommendation, approve the Michigan Department of Natural Resources Waterways Grant Agreement totaling $79,100 and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the agreement and resolution authorizing emergency funding alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, City Clerk. Now, Commissioners, what is your desires with this item? Commissioner Cambenzi?
I recommend that we approve the Michigan Department of Natural Resources Waterways Grant Agreement totaling $79,100 and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the agreement and resolution authorizing emergency funding.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Commissioner Ryan?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. Commissioner Cambenzi, anything further on the motion?
Hopefully our insurance will kick in for the other half. I think that's always the hope, but certainly $80,000 is a lot of money for this, so I'm happy with that.
Thank you, Commissioner Cambenzi. Commissioner Ryan, anything
further? And as a matter of fact, I think our insurance could possibly pay for all of it, so but it's good to have this in our back pocket to help cover the cost if we need it.
Commissioner Coyne?
I'm just happy that the city is using this money and will use the insurance money to repair what was done. Other groups in the city have done this differently, particularly the Board of Light and Power. They took $700,000 and did something different with it than repair the dam. So I think this shows good, solid, honest government. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Coyne. Any other commissioners? Any comments on the motion? Hearing none, it's been moved by Commissioner Cambenzi, seconded by Commissioner Ryan, to approve the Michigan Department of Natural Resources Waterways Grant Agreement totaling $79,100 and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the agreement and resolution authorizing the emergency funding. All in favor say yes.
Yes.
Anyone opposed say no. The motion is approved unanimously, and I think that's another unanimous roll call vote. Okay, the next item is number 12, miscellaneous City of Marquette Street Restorations. City Clerk.
Background, with the recent winter freeze-ups, approximately 60 water main and lateral breaks occurred, resulting in numerous excavations causing damage to streets and properties. Typically, the city has 8 to 12 restoration projects during a normal winter. Due to the high volume of work, outside assistance is required. Public Works crews will continue to do a portion of the restoration project as time allows. City staff requested formal proposals from three area contractors to supplement the city in providing the restorations in a timely manner. The contractors were contacted for per unit cost for street restorations as identified by the City of Marquette Public Works Department, attached as a bid tabulation. Fiscal effect, all costs associated with the restoration work are eligible for reimbursement through the governor's state of emergency declaration. Recommendation, award a contract to Oberstar Incorporated for miscellaneous street restorations in an amount not to exceed $336,895 at unit prices provided per quote, alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, City Clerk. Commissioners, what is your pleasure regarding this item? Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
I motion to award a contract to Oberstar Inc. for miscellaneous street restorations in an amount not to exceed $336,895 at unit prices provided per quote.
Thank you. Is there a second? Commissioner Ryan?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. Commissioner Stonehouse, anything further on the motion?
Well, we will be recovering from the deep freeze we had last winter for some time, and this is a significant step forward.
Thank you. Commissioner Ryan, anything further?
Yeah, I've been a witness to these in the past, not this year, where the city has had to come through and repair our street because of broken water mains. And they do a great job. But as they point out here, typically they have 8 to 12. This year we have 60 holes in the street. We certainly need some help to get it done, and I'm glad to see we're moving forward and awarding a contract to get the work done.
Commissioner Coyne.
I have another question for the city manager. A comment was made about the federal and state grant reimbursements that we are getting. We don't have any of that yet. Is that correct?
Thank you, Your Honor. That's correct, sir. We haven't received anything yet. Actually, we have Kurt Goodman, our superintendent from DPW, who's been tracking this for us. If you'd like to get a little taste of what the current status is, I'll ask him to come up to the dais, maybe describe the process he's been working with the county's disaster coordinator and his confidence and level about when we're going to be hopefully seeing resources coming.
Thank you. Why I ask the question is we don't have this money appropriated at all in our budget.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Correct. We will be taking this repair on, predicated on what you're going to hear from Mr. Goodman, that we're expecting the federal government to act and compensate us thereafter.
Yeah. Thank you. Currently, to date, the city has had $1.493 million worth of expenses related to the freezing. That includes the water main breaks, the road restoration. Also in that includes $346,000 for total reconstruction of 7th Street. The contract you're awarding tonight, I've included, part of that will be a resurfacing of 7th Street to get that main thoroughfare completed for the residents. So that cost will be part of that $336,000. We've been asked to turn in the detail of every line item, every dollar, to FEMA. And what happens next is the FEMA assessment team will start looking at our numbers. And just want to say that staff has done an excellent job documenting every dollar spent on this on the freeze situation. So those numbers were turned in on Friday at 4 o'clock. I'm very optimistic. I was around 1994. You know, I think the turnaround time is going to be a little bit quicker. All the front work that the legislation did, the representatives did, our trip to Lansing. I think this is really on the top of their list to assist not only Marquette, but all the communities in the UP. And again, you're going to see some work being done if this is approved. I think the residents deserve it. A lot of holes, you know, in the streets, should be completed in a very timely fashion.
Mr. Ryan?
Kurt, what do we actually expect to get? Are they just going to give us a bucket of money, or are these going to be loans, or what typically happens?
I think what happens, again, once they verify, this is where it's so critical that all the time and effort spent on documentation, they actually go over it. They want to make sure that what we're spending, what we have spent, is documented. Once we turn that in, they determine it's eligible, and then the way I see it right now is eventually a check will be, you know, provided to the city and, you know, other communities.
Okay, so it wouldn't be a loan, it would be an actual payout from the federal government?
Right, it'll be a grant. There are another, I believe it's Deanda, did support a bill for additional funds that will make some low-interest loans and possibly some additional grant money available. That hasn't passed the House yet.
Right. Thank you.
Any other questions, Mr. Goodman? Thank you, Mr. Goodman. We appreciate your fine work on behalf of the city. See, we have a motion by Commissioner Stonehouse, a second by Commissioner Ryan, to award contract to Oberstar for miscellaneous street restorations in an amount not to exceed $336,895 at the unit prices provided per the quote. All in favor, say yes.
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 Anyone opposed, say no. The motion is approved unanimously. The next item is number 13. I hope that's known as concerned about that's number 13, but it's water plant variable frequency drive for the water filtration plant.
Thank you, Your Honor. Background, the water filtration plant utilizes frequency, variable frequency drives, VFD, to operate the low service pumps. The VFD unit will replace the original VFD, which is in need of repair. It is most cost effective to replace the unit rather than repair, as replacement parts are scarce. Two other VFD units were replaced in 2012. The capital outlay budget contains $8,800 for this project. The budget estimate did not include a communication card and startup services, resulting in a shortfall of the approved dollar amount for this project. Below is a summary of bids. Wright Electric Company, $14,250. Code Electric Incorporated, $14,649. And JP Electric Professionals Incorporated, $14,950. Fiscal effect, a budget adjustment to the Water Capital Outlay Fund of $5,450 will be required. Due to the savings from the fluoride system replacement project, funds will be available to cover the cost. Recommendation, award a bid to Wright Electric of Marquette to furnish and install one variable frequency drive at a not-to-exceed amount of $14,250 and authorize a budget amendment of $5,450 to cover the shortage for the project. Alternatives as determined by the commission.
Thank you, City Clerk. Commissioners, what is your desire regarding this item? Commissioner Kim Benzie?
I move that we award a bid to Wright Electric of Marquette to furnish and install one variable frequency drive at a not-to-exceed amount of $14,250 and authorize a budget amendment of $5,450 to cover the shortage for the project.
Thank you, Commissioner Kim Benzie. Is there a second? Commissioner Reynolds?
Second.
Thank you. Commissioner Cambenzi, anything further on this item?
Well, I'm just reading the background. Unfortunately, sometimes you do have to replace the whole unit. In fact, I just broke my coffee press, and I'm finding this out, too. the actual glass piece is about $5 less than the total replacement. So, but we are upgrading it. It looks like we'll get a newer unit, so all is good.
I hope your coffee press didn't cost $14,000. Commissioner Reynolds, anything further?
Nothing further.
Thank you.
Are we buying Commissioner Cambenzi's coffee press?
No, we are not.
Okay, all right. Just want to make sure.
She just noted that not only does the city have to adjust their budget, but she has to adjust her personal budget. So, anything further, commissioners? It's been moved by Commissioner Cambenzi, seconded by Commissioner Reynolds, to award a bid to Wright Electric Marquette to furnish and install one variable frequency drive at a not-to-exceed amount of $14,250 and authorize a budget amendment of $5,450 to cover the shortage for the project. All in favor say yes.
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 Any opposed say no. The motion is passed unanimously. That concludes our business portion of the agenda.
We have one more item.
I know. I'm getting to that. do we want to have any comments before we go into a closed session, or do we want to do those after the closed session as we normally do? Okay. A motion would be in order to allow us to go into closed session. Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse.
Your Honor, I move that we go into closed session pursuant to MCL 15.268 Boleg E to discuss trial strategy in connection with the matter of We Energies versus the City of Marquette pending in the Michigan Tax Tribunal for the reason that an open meeting would have a detrimental financial effect on the litigating position of the city.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion? Commissioner Coyne? It's been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, seconded by Commissioner Coyne, to go into closed session as pursuant to the motion that he read. All in favor say yes.
We need a roll call, yes. Your Honor.
Yes. You want me?
We need a roll call vote on
actually
this.
Roll.
Yes.
Call? Okay.
The statute requires it.
Yes, Your Honor. Commissioner Cambenzi?
Yes.
Commissioner Campana?
Yes.
Commissioner Coyne?
Yes.
Commissioner Reynolds?
Yes.
Commissioner Ryan?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
Yes.
And Mayor Nemi?
Yes. The motion is approved unanimously. We are going to go in closed session once the chambers are cleared of those people who are not participating in closed session.
session.
Yep. She'll be back.
The maven of the media is not here.
I think we could wait for a minute or so, yeah, let people get back into the chambers.
Two. You meant to leave early for Kyle.
Good.
You got cuffs, huh?
Okay, we are now back in open session. Commissioners, what is your desire regarding the matters discussed in closed session?
Your Honor, I will move that the City Commission retain the services of Jack Van Koving and the law firm of Bloom Sluggett Morgan PC. They represent the city in the case filed by We Energies against the City of Marquette and the Michigan Tax Tribunal, and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign an engagement letter with Mr. Van Koving and the law firm.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse. Is there a second for the motion? Commissioner Ryan?
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse, anything further on the motion?
Only that this is certainly a critical thing we have to do. We have to make sure that we can defend ourselves against We Energies, and they are the largest taxpayer in the city, and you know, what they're asking will significantly reduce that. So we need to have the attorneys there.
Thank you. Commissioner Ryan?
Yeah, just to reiterate that for those who aren't following it, they have filed with the Tax Tribunal to, as Commissioner Stonehouse said, significantly reduce their tax obligation to the City of Marquette and County of Marquette and other local taxing institutions. So I think it's certainly important that the City of Marquette step forward and defend our right. They certainly have a right to do what they're doing, but we certainly have a right to protect our taxpayers and our community, and by engaging counsel that's experienced and expert in this area.
Okay, anything further from any commissioners? Hearing none, it was moved by Commissioner Stonehouse, seconded by Commissioner Ryan, that the commission retain the services of Jack Van Koering and the law firm of Bloom Sluggett Morgan PC to represent the city in the case filed by We Energies against the City of Marquette in the Michigan Tax Tribunal, and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign an engagement letter with Mr. Van Koering and the law firm. All in favor, say yes.
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 Anyone opposed, say no. The motion is approved unanimously. Okay, the next item on the agenda are comments from the commission. We'll start with Commissioner Reynolds.
Just a few comments with the few people that made public comment. Living in the city and formerly living downstate, Run or Die has always been a huge deal down in Lansing and Ann Arbor and all those places, and I used to have all of my friends, we would take a carpool down there to do Run or Die down there, and pretty excited it's here. I have probably 10 people I know coming up just to Marquette just to do Run or Die because they love Marquette, they love Run or Die, they're coming up to do it, so it's pretty excited about that, and I'm glad that we're doing it. I'm glad that guy is coming forward and throwing it at Marquette. The other comment, I missed the lady's name about the UP Pride Rainbow Fest on September 6th. That sounds pretty awesome, and I will be willing to participate, and that is all.
Thank you, Commissioner Reynolds. Commissioner Ryan.
Just, again, that run was on June 28th. Was that the date, I believe? Well, you can check on that. I guess I was just going to say, you know, as someone who walks around Marquette frequently, it's nice to see the ice gone. At least I hope it's permanently gone, because for a while it made for some pretty interesting pictures out in the harbor, but the harbor looks as it should now. Second, I believe the street cleanup is all done for the City of Marquette, or basically done, and once again want to congratulate and thank the city crews for getting the job done. It's been a tough spring and late in coming, and the pickups were late, but the streets look good, and really glad that we could again carry out that project very successfully. Also really pleased to hear that the city staff has recommended and the commission approved repairing the streets. As I mentioned during the discussion, typically 8 to 12 streets are torn up and need some repair. In this case, we have nearly 60. I know as people, as they drive around town, they're well aware of this. I'm also pleased that we're going to work on 7th Street, even though we may have to do more in the future. I think it's really too much to have people having to drive through, particularly that street right now with the way it's been torn up. And so getting even a temporary fix there will be important. So I think these are important steps as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Ryan. Commissioner Coyne.
Well, thank you. I have a couple questions. I'd like to ask the city attorney to describe the qualifications of Jack Van Covering and perhaps why we chose him and his law firm to represent us. I think the citizens ought to know we just didn't pick a name out of the phone book. Who is this person?
Well, I don't have his academic credentials, but I can tell you this, that he is the former chair of the Michigan Tax Tribunal. He's very well respected in this area and does this kind of litigation. I mean, this is something that he does for a living, and with his background, and I know he's been doing work for the county already in this area.
Okay, thank you. I think people need to know that, the quality of this person, and that how important that is in representing the community's interest. Thank you. I have a question for the city manager. Could you elaborate on the very justifiable and reasonable concerns that the people discussed today about the helicopter? Anything you have to add about what's going on there? I mean, I need to know, they need to know. I can certainly sympathize with the plight that they're seemingly facing. What's up with that?
Thank you, sir. Certainly, we all are very sympathetic to that, and it's been a very fluid process so far. They'd mentioned that we really were playing a little bit of catch-up when their concerns were first heard. It wasn't something that had been shared through some public process. Somebody in the neighborhood had heard something and shared it with more people. And we're working with the hospital to try to get through the process. It's not, I wouldn't characterize it the way maybe some of the people who spoke this evening would. There's a learning process with the people from the hospital in terms of how to actually submit applications, what type of supporting documentation is there, the kind of things that city staff needs to look at to meet FAA regulations, the National Fire Safety Code regulations for operating helipads, and of course site plans and all of the other kind of environmental mitigation that I know many of the commissioners got a chance to feel firsthand when the event was switched to the Barry Center, and just what it means to have the rotor wash and what it means to have some of the impact of that in the area. So we need to see a little bit more about their plan and what's going on. I'm grateful to share that just today MGH CEO Banyos reached out, and we're going to be meeting on Wednesday, June 11th, to talk about their interest and to chat about some of the ways they might be able to reach out, not just to city staff, but to Northern Michigan University and staff, to the residents in the neighborhood, to really start making this a more open process pursuant to some of the suggestions this evening from the Boykamas and from the other residents in the area. So I know it can create a lot of anxiety when something like this is proposed for an area. Of course, in my role, I stay completely neutral. It's the commission's decision ultimately, but it's our job to make sure everybody, the residents and the commission, all understand what is being proposed before any kind of an action would be taken. In this particular case, the Planning Commission will be acting on your behalf. The process isn't an administrative one. It will get forwarded to the Planning Commission for their review and approval. And so we've been reaching out to many of the residents of that neighborhood to make sure that they understand what the next steps are in the process, when they need to participate, where the information is that they're looking for. And so we're trying to keep everybody informed.
Could I ask another question? When the Planning Commission does decide, does the commission then have to decide after they decide?
Let me double check with that, sir. Some things, of course, the Planning Commission is authorized to do under their own authority. Some things get elevated to the commission for final approval. That part's not clear to me because we haven't seen the plan yet for what they're proposing to do. And there are different rules that apply for temporary uses versus some kind of fixed permanent structure. So we really haven't seen anything yet that can give us insight into into many of the questions that were posed by residents tonight.
Okay. Well, thank you. I think it's critical for the citizens to know, you know, that so they can for sure come to the Planning Commission when that's being discussed. And I think that shows the value, the true value of public comment at the last meeting. That was news to me. I had no idea the helicopter was coming till the public mentioned it. And I think it was a very good example of a positive public comment input, as opposed to, I want to just say, I'm still very happy we limited to public comment to one occasion. And this evening we saw, I think, good positive results from the community saying, here's a real concern, and as well as last week, as opposed to, I know how difficult it is for my fellow commissioners and, frankly, people watching the commission meeting, either on television or being present, to the demeaning and remarks that are made. And I just want the commission's, my fellow commissioners, to know and understand all of us here, I believe, are here to serve the community and to be are the recipient of just the negatives and then just leave the building is very difficult. My sympathies and my understanding, and it's just hard sometimes, and I think the community understands it's hard, but the people running for commission and the people presently serving are doing it because they want to serve the community and they love it. And you don't want to lose sight of that by the negatives. And I think the public comment is valuable when it's positive or, in this case, raising an issue which needed to be raised. So it's just very difficult to hear the same thing over and over and over again. And I appreciate my fellow commissioners' hard work and dedication to public service.
Thank you, Commissioner Coyne. Commissioner Cambenzi?
Just real quickly, I guess, the Michigan Tax Tribunal, I just want to comment on that. You know, what started off as one lawsuit, you know, in our state has certainly set a precedent, and here we go. We just watched Marquette Township go through this. And here we are with our largest taxpayers. So, again, the only thing that I want to mention is that this is every year we would lose this amount in taxes. You start to add that up over 10 years, it's a considerable amount of money. And we all know what that means, whether it's roads, streets, or program services. This is a large amount we won't be able to do. So, again, as Commissioner Stonehouse said, it's critical to move forward, certainly immediately, and I'd just like to thank the county for willing to be our partners on this. Buck Buchanan, I was really sad to see his passing in the news. He certainly started something great with our disc golf, and I'm looking forward to all of the people that love it continuing to carry it on. I think it'll be something that hopefully we'll see the world championships here. And certainly the continuation of the golf course or the disc golf course expanding. And lastly, just congrats to our Marquette girls U10. As someone who played sports growing up, I think it's great to see that so many girls are playing hockey. I always thought I wanted to, but I didn't want to be the only one or the only other one playing. So I think it's really cool to see a whole team of girls that age active in a sport that traditionally wasn't a girls' sport and also going out to be state champions. So I'd just like to concur that Marquette is the state hockey capital. So,
thank you, Commissioner Cambenzi. Commissioner Campana.
I, too, would like to thank or congratulate the under-10 girls hockey team. That means we probably got 10 more years of state champions coming through. We'll probably see.
Yep.
Seems like every year, every team has been winning, so that's good for Marquette. And second, I'm really glad to see the Delft Theater project moving forward. That area of the block looks a little worn right now, and if they should go ahead and fix, they will fix that up, and it'll look very, very nice, and it'll be a unique place with a restaurant, theater, combination. It'll add to the uniqueness of Marquette, downtown Marquette. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Campana. Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse?
Well, not to overbeat it, I guess, but the helicopter issue certainly deserves much further examination, and I'm certain the city is going to be doing that, so we'll see how that comes out, but certainly it is an issue for many people. On a happier note, this weekend, the city of Marquette will be competing in the All-American City Award competition for the National League of Cities. You might be aware that there were 25 cities selected nationwide for the competition. 10 of those will be selected as All-American cities. That competition will occur in Denver, Colorado. We have a delegation of 11 people going out to do the final representation of the city, which is in effect a presentation given to the judges. We do have representatives of the Food Co-op, Peter White Public Library, YMCA, DDA, as well as the city itself. And the National League, I think, did something a little different this year in that they selected a theme for the competition, and that theme was healthy communities. And when you think of Marquette and what we do here and all the things we have going on here, that really fits the city to a T. For example, you know, we've got the New Cayman on Trail Network, we've got the Arnold Heritage Trail Network, both of which essentially terminate in the city of Marquette as the nexus. We have our own city trails. We have a tremendous food co-op going, brand new quarters for it. In fact, the largest co-op in the state of Michigan is right here, is the Marquette Food Co-op. All the education they do with healthy food, their emphasis on making it available not only to private consumers, but certainly also the institutional users. The UP Food Bank that's headquartered here in Marquette, the YMCA, all of the programs they offer across the entire spectrum of healthy choices and healthy opportunities. Peter White Public Library is so deeply involved in teaching, educating, and coordinating many of those same issues, particularly working with an Alzheimer's program. And, of course, the events that the DDA coordinates that, again, are driven so much by healthy choices and presenting a healthy community. And the farmers market is only the most obvious choice of that. But when you think of other events that they sponsor or partially sponsor, I think it comes into focus, too. So let's wish the city delegation well and see if they can't bring home an award. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Stonehouse. And I'd also like to thank you for representing us on behalf of the city, along with Mr. Whitney at the All-American Awards. Thank you. I just had the one thing I want to point out in the helipad process. I believe as the Planning Commission hears it, they will notify the residents within so many hundred feet of the location. I'd also like to compliment Marquette General Hospital, Duke Life Point, for they had planned to land the helicopter in the parking lot adjacent to the trauma center, and after contact from the city, they did agree to move that to the Berry Event Center, which is a much better location for that. We're fortunate if we can get a ambulance helicopter here. I think it'll really enhance our healthcare system, but I think we need to balance that with the needs of our citizens, and I'm confident that reasonable solution can be found. I'd like to go back to the streets item that we approved tonight for repairing the streets. We had 60 water mains and laterals that had to be repaired this year. Has left a lot of scars in the streets, but I think it reminds us of the yeoman duty that our public works crews did from January through the beginning of April. It's just amazing, and fortunately they're probably getting some rest now after the pickup, or although we've had some water mains, I guess as recently as a couple weeks ago, break from the frozen or the winter freeze. So again, I think everyone, as you see someone from our public works crews, thank them for what they've done this winter. Lastly, I would be honored to participate in the Rainbow Festival and proclaim that Saturday as Rainbow Day in Marquette. So, City Manager, if you'd have staff follow up with Miss Susan Holliday, and
arrange that for the meeting in appropriate meeting in August and let them know to contact me. We can put that on the calendar. So that's all I have. City Manager, any comments?
Thank you, Your Honor. Only first to thank the Commission for the great support this evening, helping the City Attorney and I position for the tax tribunals. These are very fluid for the community. They're kind of an arcane element of what goes on in local government. Fortunately, with the exception of lawyers, not a lot of people spend time in courts or in these processes. We see them all the time. But what it typically means is you have a deadline that you have to meet. It's usually very tight, and it requires very fluid decision-making. So it was great serendipity we were able to get such prompt action. We really appreciate it. I also, too, wanted to thank the Commission. There's an awful lot of support that you're doing above and beyond, and the community doesn't normally hear about it. But in addition to the Mayor Pro Tem working with the All-American Cities team that Kyle Whitney's been pulling together and all the great support we're getting from around the community for that, we've got a number of other meetings that members of the Commission will be attending this month, providing that kind of representation of Marquette in national international forum. We have commissioners going to support the Michigan Municipal League's Region 7 Conference. That's the representation of all communities in the Upper Peninsula coming together to provide voice to legislative issues and policy concerns that they have that feeds down into Lansing. The mayor is reciprocating with the mayor of Thunder Bay, Ontario, for this year's Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Seaways Conference. You recall we hosted last summer with great aplomb, and we are returning the favor to one of our sister cities here in the Great Lakes region, who's, again, an organization that's doing a lot of great policy work that, were they not there, we would be taking that on our shoulders. And I'd also like to thank the commissioners who've been spending time working both on the Next Michigan Zone and the Smart Zone. There's travel this month to start coordinating again with the other communities that are involved in those programs to make sure we're getting all of the lessons learned and the best practices to make sure that we can set a new high bar if and when we choose to start walking down those paths. And then also I wanted to make the community aware we've got still a couple of evenings this week that have some interesting information. It's all posted out on the city website, but we have another Local Development Finance Authority town hall meeting tomorrow. So if folks weren't able to see the first two, we've got another one tomorrow, and we'll be prepared to answer questions. We have pretty much the same crew that was at the other ones, including the former city manager from Houghton, who can speak directly to their experiences. And then for folks who are interested in arts and culture, we have the final report coming from the Art and Culture Planning Group, the planning effort that the Arts and Culture Committee took on, and that will be presented to the City Commission on Wednesday night. And so if you're interested in seeing what the vision is for the next 10 to 20 years for how the community will embrace art and culture and embed that in every different part of who we are, that would be a great meeting for you to attend. I'd encourage everybody with that interest to come out. And that's it for me, Your Honor.
Thank you, City Manager. We're adjourned.